viewers, tonight we once again bring to you the topic that is raging on right now, the debate over whether school campuses should reopen, if it is safe, whether to send children to schools or not. Although many states have allowed for the schools to reopen and for several classes, schools have begun to function. But the debate really rages on, and amidst this, we also now have the central government telling states to ensure that the staff in the schools is vaccinated on priority. This is the Education Ministry writing letters saying that we need to prioritize the teachers as well as schools, and more states reopen. The teaching staff must be vaccinated. Interestingly, two high courts today, came forward and made similar observations on physical attendance, on offline classes being mandatory for students. And neither of the two courts are actually in favor of it. In fact, the Telangana High Court said that the institutions can continue online classes, but there must be guidelines issued for holding offline classes, and the government, the state, cannot coerce parents to send their children to school. They cannot force them to come to school. And no action should be taken if the students don't attend school physically. The plea was actually after the government decided to reopen schools. And the plea that was filed in the court was against reopening boarding schools, residential schools and hostels. And the court has put a stay on residential schools to challenge their understandably greater, but has allowed the schools to reopen while saying that it shouldn't be mandatory for students to attend. Madras High Court saying similar things, that the government should not make physical classes mandatory, cannot force students to attend physical classes, and the government should reply on this by September 7th. Now, while this is the view on one hand, on the other hand, many are saying that schools need to reopen and children need to get back to schools for their future, for the academic reasons, for even their mental health reasons. But there is also concern about how easy or difficult will it be to maintain COVID protocol in the educational institutions. And I also want to bring to you some data that we have collated on COVID cases in children in states that have reopened schools. In some of these states where the schools actually opened almost a month ago, the positivity rate for children has gone up. For example, in the state of Punjab, the positivity rate has actually, from July 6.5% to now August 16.1%. Remember, we even discussed the case of Punjab, where in a few cases, there were a large number of positive cases that emerged in a couple of schools that had to then be shut down. Similarly, if you see in Bihar, it's the other state that has shown a jump. For children, the positivity rate in July was 6.2%. It's now in August gone to 11.5%. Now, these are two states that did open their schools much earlier. Punjab in the first week of August, Bihar on 16th of August. Madhya Pradesh has also seen an uptick from July 6.2% positivity rate to 9.1% in August. Here also the schools open on August 5th, so it's been a few days. Gujarat, 5.7% to 8.2% in August. So the rise is lesser, but it is there. And the schools here, though, opened much earlier on July 26th, over a month ago. Chhattisgarh is the other one where there is an uptick. And so is then Uttarakhand. These are the states that opened up their schools at least 3 weeks ago. Then there are some other states there where the difference isn't so big. For example, Maharashtra, there has not been any rise in positivity rate amongst children, but Maharashtra has been extremely careful. They've only just about reopened the schools for limited classes from 17th of August. You also have Jharkhand. So these are the places where there hasn't been much difference. Hence again, the debate continues whether there is a direct link or not and what should be done, which is the bigger of the two evils. Let's talk about it. Let's get our experts in and explore all the angles when it comes to the policy for sending our children to schools in the middle of a pandemic. Dr. Rajesh Haseja, Director, Principal, Indraprastha International Group of Schools. Sarvanan, Spokesperson for DMK. Captain Ganesh Karnik, Spokesperson for Karnataka BJP. Dr. Jyoti Gupta, Director, Principal for DPS Cyberbad and KR Mangalam GK2. Joins me this evening, Dr. Sanjeev Bagai, Chairman for Nephron Clinics. And Dr. Bagai, good evening to you. Let's start off with you. The data tells a mixed story. There is also an argument to be made that, well, the mortality rate isn't so high. Children are, you know, fighting this back much better than adults. But there are many who say that we can't afford this risk right now since children are not vaccinated. Where do you stand on this debate?
Good evening. Thank you for having me on the show. Good evening, everyone. So let's look at pure science and data very, very carefully. Tanvi, the important two points are caution and precaution. Now, when we are looking at a very, very vulnerable group of children, and the CDC data which has come out today is 22% of the total COVID positives in the world this year onwards is in the pediatric age group, which is double of what was last year. And in some states in internationally, there has been 400% to 800% increase after school opening in the pediatric cases, keeping in mind that there is a Delta variant, which is more invasive, more transmissible, more infective. And there's a new variant now, which is a breakaway called as C1.2, which is in fact even more deadly than Delta. So the initial reports have come in. Now, the children present in a very different manner, although a lot of them are in a milder manner, but the severe cases have a very high mortality rate. Now, in schools specifically, there are three important points. Keeping in mind that this is airborne and this virus in terms of microaerosols can travel more than 60 feet. It can linger on in the air in an empty room from 9 hours to 12.2 hours, even after a fleeting contact of 15 seconds. Ventilation becomes a huge issue. A lot of the large private schools will be able to deal with the ventilation issue, but the smaller schools or the schools in the government setups may not be able to deal with it. We also know that it travels through AC ducts, through HVAC units, and there is something which you call as a long jump COVID. It can travel from one room to another room. Children are going to go in, which are practically unvaccinated, will require a double mask. So what do we need to do? I think if we wait till November, December, that means let this quarter of the year go in a hybrid model. It will be much better for children. We know that internationally, Israel, US, UK data states that opening of the schools has a huge surge, keeping in mind that children are more susceptible towards long COVID. 30% of children are at the end of 6 months to 1 year with asymptomatic infection land up with long COVID. That's a sheer disaster for innocent children, especially in their smaller immune profile. What do we need to do? I think we need a hybrid model with online and offline for the time being. We need to stagger the timings, part of the children in the morning shift, part in the afternoon or the evening shift. I think the entire system of ventilation and air filtration needs to be relooked at. And the medical units in the schools need to be having a huge revamp to identify the clinical vulnerable, to identify children with comorbidities, children with bronchial asthma, respiratory disorders, obesity, mild hypertension, all these exist in children. And more importantly is to ensure every part of the school staff, including the teachers, are fully vaccinated. And I'm stressing on fully vaccinated because one vaccine is not enough in the Delta strain. It gives an inadequate coverage. In fact, there are some studies worldwide which have said that even two vaccines are insufficient. So fully vaccinated, and the parents and the home members of the school need to be, of the children need to be fully vaccinated. Okay. So my bottom line is, it's a little premature to open right now. We should wait.
Dr. Bagai, would you say that, you know, the staff being fully vaccinated with two doses needs to be an absolute essential?
I think absolutely. You look at worldwide data, which has come out from International Society of Infectious Diseases, ISDC. You look at CDC data, which has all come out in the last 24, 48 hours. One vaccine gives a very poor coverage. Two vaccines is the norm. In fact, Israel and US are the two countries which have said that three vaccines is fully vaccinated. So we are not looking at a booster of a third dose right now, but I think two vaccines is a must. One vaccine is as good as leaving people largely vulnerable to get infection.
Okay, so fair enough. So very clearly, strong views on not taking the risk right now and not putting, you know, little children, innocent children in the way of harm. That's what Dr. Sanjeev Bagai has to say. Let me bring in Dr. Jyoti Gupta as well. Dr. Gupta, there are also very strong arguments to be made in the favor of reopening schools, right from the mental health of children to, you know, a proper education that they haven't had the kind in the last 1.5 years. What's your view?
So there are a lot of learning gaps, and we can't deny that. The children who have, let us say, passed class 10 with 70% of the syllabus being done and the exams not happening, these children are in class 11 now, and the next year they're going to go to 12 with the full syllabus on. I really am not sure that all the learning gaps that exist at this point of time, how the diagnosis will be done, how it will be dealt. Reopening of the schools is very, very important. But I do agree with Dr. Bagai that all the staff members, every staff on the school premises has to be vaccinated, because the last time that we reopened the schools, just before the examinations to do the practical exams, there were a lot of asymptomatic children who took the infection back home, who also, you know, carried the infection to the schools. The teachers got infected. In fact, we ended up losing a lot of staff members, a lot of principals who kept going to the school. So it's important that everybody is vaccinated, not just in the school, but also the parents of the children who are coming to the school. They are vaccinated also, so that we can minimize the infection. And of course, needless to say that the children have to mask up. It's again going to be very difficult to ensure that for 4 hours that the children who are sitting in the classroom, or 3 hours, they will be sitting with the double masks. They have to only sit in the classrooms. You can't allow them to go outside the classroom. So assemblies, the breaks have been strictly said no to. But then, again, the question is, if we are talking about the mental health, are we only wanting the children to come back and do the academics in the school? They can't, you know, do the arts, visual art, performing arts. They can't do the sports. Then we are talking about, you know, calling the children, half the children on one day, half the children on the second day, or half in the morning, half in the afternoon. The ground reality is very, very difficult. And very different from this. To be able to implement all this in the schools is not going to be easy, because our smallest schools also have a minimum 1,000 children. So how are we going to maintain the social distancing? How are we going to contain these children in the classrooms is going to be a challenge. It may not be impossible, but there are going to be a lot of challenges
I want to get to the details of this. And Saravanan, maybe you can come in on this as well, since, you know, your state has also decided to reopen schools. There are obviously the basic challenges in a country like ours, where each class has 70 students. You know, there is not enough space always. They're all, you know, sitting so close to each other to maintain this kind of distancing. No matter how much spaced out the benches may be, or the, you know, alternate days and those kind of things you do. Secondly, and this is what I'm wondering, what has been the response of academicians to, you know, to the suggestion of partially online and partially offline? How does that work? Is the teacher looking at the students who are inside the class, or looking at the students who are on the computer? How are they going to manage this, Saravanan?
Tanvi, we are in a novel situation. We have to innovate. There's no choice to be or not to be. We don't know. We will know only from tomorrow. The challenges, see, the experts here spoke about the challenges that we are facing when we open up the schools. So we have, the SOPs are in place, the teachers to be compulsorily vaccinated, and the masks for children. We know better whether we will be able to enforce that on the students or not. And we are saying that we'll have alternate days, classes, and only 50% of the students' strength will be taken up in a class. So everything is going to be new, and we'll have to see how this system is going to work. Then only we can come to a conclusion how this is, whether this is going to be successful. Okay. And definitely, see, leaving, staying at home has a lot of issues for the vulnerable section. The haves always, it's not a problem at all. They'll have educated parents at home. They'll be able to supplement the child's education. And there will be abundance of tech. So there will not be a problem. If there are two or three children, there will be no problem. Each one of them will have a laptop or a computer, whatever, to attend their online classes. But look at the have-nots. If there are two children, will they be able to afford those two online, two phones for their online, simultaneous online classes? What about midday meals? Midday meals played a very, very important role in ensuring that the children are getting nutritious food. We had breakfast also in our schools. So these are all the things which forced the governments to ensure that, okay, we'll start opening up. And one good news is that we are starting these classes only from 9, 10, 11, 12. Of course, all over the world, the classes are from, I think they have started the US, UK and all, they had from first standard or fifth standard. But yeah. Now we are started only from the ninth standard. So we can explain these people, these students, we can expect that they'll all be little matured. Okay. So they'll be able to understand. They have been cooped up for the last 1 year. They have seen the horrors of this pandemic. So we'll be able to ensure that they follow the protocols to an extent.
Okay. Okay, so let me take that point you said. You have to wait and watch and see how it goes, but it must be done. That is what the DMK has to say. Dr. Rajesh Sasija, would you agree? And of course, there is no easy answer to this. There is no right or wrong answer that we already know. We are all trying to find what's the best course of action. But Dr. Sanjeev Bagai, for example, says it's too soon. Your view.
Good evening. With all respect to Dr. Bagai, I would respond in three ways. Number one, I'm not a medical expert, but Professor Bhargav of ICMR says it is very safe sending primary children to the school. They have antibodies. WHO and AIIMS study recently concluded says middle and senior school children are fit. Anyhow, I am not commenting on the medical part of it. But I'm coming to the emotional and mental well-being of children. Dr. Bagai also said it that we must open in a hybrid model, which means he also agreeing that we must open. And that's where I say we must reopen school. Talking about Dr. Jyoti, when she said learning gap, I am not concerned about the learning at all. Please remember, children learn anyway. And education is when you forget physics, chemistry, and mathematics. So I am not here to talk about covering of syllabi or uncovering of syllabi. Children come to school to meet their friends, social well-being, social inspiration, inspiration from their team, from teachers, collaboration with their friends, inspiration from their friends, competition with their friends. These are the skills and values which make child and well-being. If locking them into the four walls of the room is the only solution, I'm with that. But that is not the only solution. That means the third part is we have to open up with all precautions. I fully agree with Dr. Bagai. Entire staff has to be vaccinated. Wherever they are not, we must immediately take priority basis. Number two, the precaution in terms of sanitizing, masks, social distancing. You know, children making them aware about it, though most of the children are now aware it, but still making it a priority that these are the things to be taken care. Thirdly, when children are in the coming to the school, as Dr. Bagai said, we have to identify those children who may be prone to any kind of infection, identifying them in a different way and taking the normal children in a classroom where less children are there, social distancing, calling them first shift, second shift, third shift, flexible, whatever you call it. But I strongly feel 17 months, there is so much agony on the children. Talk to the counselor. They are saying children are becoming aggressive, stubborn. They are losing connect with the children. Isolation is becoming a big harmful. Therefore, my humble appeal to everybody, let medical fraternity guide us. They are the expert. But we must reopen school. whichever way they want, twice a week, thrice a week, once a week, four times a week, 3 hours, 5 hours. But we must open as soon as possible, not for examination, not for assessment, but for collaboration with the friends, with the teammates, with the teachers.
You know, so you are right. I think the larger concern for many academicians and teachers and professors and principals is the mental health impact that the children are actually undergoing. And that becomes a big concern. Some are divided on whether accessibility and teaching is a challenge, and if everybody is getting the right kind of education, that's an argument. But if you have to leave it to medical experts, then Dr. Bagai, there is a divided view. You have a certain, you know, clear view on it. The ICMR seems to suggest a different view on it. We've had the Maharashtra task force suggesting that right now is not the right time. Individually in different states, the different task forces are giving different kind of view. Mr. Chandrakant Laharia has been vociferously on the other side of the whole debate. So how does anybody decide?
Yeah, so Tanvi, I think we have to look at very minute details, because the devil lies in the detail. I think the two most neglected parts of our society, apart from not paying too much of attention to pediatrics, one is ventilation. And I'm stressing on this again and again, because that's going to be the new buzzword for the next decade or so. I think electrical engineering to refit not only schools, but offices and workspace, because ventilation is very specific science. I think we need to focus on the positioning of the windows, the number of cycles of air which are recycled. We need to look at the toilets and the washrooms of children. That this kind of virus spreads through the toilets and through the sewage. We need to focus on the masks disposal in schools. We need to not only ensure 2 vaccinations for all teachers and support staff in school, but 2 vaccinations for parents of the children who are attending the school. Children can be asymptomatic carriers 49.5% of the time. They can get it and carry this infection back home. There is an extremely interesting and a landmark study from South Korea in which one asymptomatic teacher infected 50% of the school children in 15 minutes. I'm repeating it again. One teacher, 50% of the school students infected in 15 minutes. I think we need to be very cautious. We need to tread slowly. We need to revamp the healthcare units of the schools. Very often, the large schools are doing good, but the smaller schools sometimes take this as a neglected part. We also should ensure that the children should get the influenza vaccine, because the influenza vaccine gives a cross-reactivity of 15 to 20% as a cross-reactive protection against COVID. So I think we need a very gradual reopening. And the reason I'm saying to let these 2 or 3 months pass by is we have touched 65 crore vaccines plus in India. We are touching 1 crore per day. By the end of December, I'm absolutely certain we will reach the figure of 180 to 190 crore injections. That's about 80% of the vaccinable population of India would be vaccinated. We will reach a significant level of decreased transmission by reaching community-acquired immunity. We have waited, and it's a huge challenge for the children. But my humble request is, let's be patient for the next 2 months. Every passing day, we are reaching close to 1 crore of vaccines. Every crore of vaccines is decreasing the community infection further and further down, which is good for us. And last, most importantly, is children manifest very differently as compared to adults. Their immune systems are different. I'm not going into the medical details of it. Mm-hmm. The mental health of children needs a lot of attention, and schools will have to invest emotionally and medically in having school counselors and psychologists, because we need very, very quick pickup of subtle signs in children. Otherwise, we'll have long-term complications.
Okay, and that is a point I do want to, you know, pick up and explore further. But let me first bring in Captain Ganesh Karnik of the Karnataka BJP. Captain Karnik, this is what factors was the decision taken for Karnataka? Because like I said, this is a tricky one. And again, I come back to the point of how are we going to ensure that offline and online can parallel take place? This suggestion has been made by courts, by various medical experts also. But is it easy to implement?
Good evening to all the co-panelists, and I've been listening to all of them patiently. In fact, it's a very educative kind of an experience. Like most of them said, it's a very, very complex situation. None of us have a standard set model for, you know, handling this particular pandemic. Well, in Karnataka, we have started the classes, reopened the classes in phases. And most of the words of caution which Dr. Sanjay was mentioning, that has been taken into account. And initially it was the degree college, and then it was the higher secondary, 11th and 12th, and 9, 10, 11 and 12. And now from 6th onwards, we are starting 6, 7 and 8. But like the discussion has taken a shape now, now it is staggered. All the children will not come to the school at the same point of time. The timings are staggered. And since the timings are staggered, number of classrooms available are much, much larger. So in each class, per bench, there'll be only one student. Besides this, we have also ensured that every teacher, every non-teaching staff in the school is vaccinated. Both the vaccination has been done. Only those children, those teachers can be permitted. Those support staff can be permitted to come to the school. In the school premises, all those precautionary steps like, you know, keeping hand sanitizers, maintaining distance, having mask, and everything is being ensured. And education department as well as the health department are working hand in glove. So each one is at the assistance of the others. Besides this, children have been asked to bring water from their home. And if there is a requirement of water, the boiled water, hot water is made available in the school. Then disposal of the, you know, mask is being organized in the schools. Even the buses are, you know, used. They are used only with the limited capacity. All these precautions are definitely considered. But the problem is, like you all mentioned, whether we are, we'll be able to maintain these strict protocol in every school, number one. Number two, the hybrid model that we have been talking about, now the children who are supposed to come to the school will only come if parents are permitted. Number two, if the children have any other health-related issue, these children are not required to come to the school. The third issue is, only those children who want to come to the school are permitted, and those who are not coming, there'll be absolutely no issue. And the hybrid model that you talked of is being considered, and children can continue to sit at home and continue their education. And we have started this. Let us see how it comes out. One point which I would like to mention as a parent is the social skills which are being discussed about. Children have lost a lot of things with regard to social skills. These past 19 months have been pretty bad. And there is also an urgent need of bringing children back to the schools. So, and Karnataka government has not taken a political decision. This decision has been taken in consultation with the task force, which comprises of doctors from various faculties. And their considered opinion is being implemented in the state. And I feel this is the most rational decision the government has taken, as there has been different opinions like we have heard now. And considering all these factors and taking into account the suggestions made by the task force and the doctors, the government has taken the decision.
Okay. So as the various states look into this matter and design their own policies, I want to bring out a couple of points to see if we are actually getting it right or we are actually sitting and writing policies on paper which may not be practical at all on ground. And again, Dr. Jyoti, how does this work, partially offline and partially online? Are there going to be two separate classes then? You know, half the class which is in school has one hour, and then those are at home have another hour. And then do we have enough teachers and enough time to actually carry out so many classes?
So most of the teachers are going to be in school. In fact, all the teachers have to be in school. And the classes are going to be taken out of the classrooms where the devices are going to be there. These devices are going to transmit the content that is being transacted in the class to the students who are sitting at home. So that is the hybrid model. You can't just put a phone device in the class. There has to be a proper infrastructure where the computers with the, you know, with the camera and with the audio input and video input and the audio output and the video output has to be put there. So that is one way of doing it. And the other way is that all the children log into the devices, whether they are in school or they are sitting at home, and the teacher is teaching in the classroom, and that is being transmitted to the children, who are sitting at home also. So the hybrid model is actually the way ahead. So whatever is going to be taught in the classrooms have to be transmitted there. And because we have seen the two-way communication and it is possible, it is doing well when all children are at home, I'm sure when the teacher is teaching in the class, the teacher will alternate between discussing between the children who are sitting online and who are in the classroom. So, dividing the entire class into two and first taking it into the classroom and then taking it with the children online may not be possible.
Yes, fair enough. But what percentage of schools are actually equipped to handle this kind of an hybrid model? I can understand in big cities like, Delhi or Chennai or Mumbai. But what about outside these cities?
Yes. So most teachers have been teaching online during this time. I've seen a lot of government school teachers also teach online. The devices have been a problem. But because the teachers have the devices and the internet also is not very expensive these days. So it's doable. It's not as if it's not going to be possible. Mm-hmm. And anyways, when I compare the private schools with the government schools, even when we reopened the schools, last year in October, the numbers in the government schools were far too many than the private schools. In fact, the private schools students are more privileged. They have the devices. But when the government school children, they get the midday meals in school, they get the uniform, they get the books, and they get to come to the school. So the numbers coming to the school in the government schools are much larger.
Yes.
Than in the private schools. So, in fact, it is a win-win situation where the children, they can come to the school and the transaction can be done in the school. That's a very good situation. But if the parents are not willing to send the children to school and they want the classes in the hybrid model, also the children can come for the practicals to the school. They can come for doubt clearing to the school. So there can be, slowly the numbers will build. And the parents will become more confident. And once we have the parents and the staff vaccinated, I'm sure the confidence will slowly come back.
Okay.
And so, hybrid model is doable.
Okay. You say hybrid model is doable. Before I take that point across to Dr. Hasija, Saravanan, I had one more question, because today center has also highlighted the aspect of vaccinating the staff and the states needing to ensure that, by the end of this month, the entire staff is vaccinated. Is there a clear policy that your state has devised on prioritizing the teaching staff in both public and private sector?
Yeah, Tanvi. There is a clear mandate ensuring that the students have to be vaccinated. I think we have given a deadline also that they have to get vaccinated before September 1st, that is tomorrow, or they'll be given a day for 10 more days.
You mean the teaching staff?
Teaching staff.
Teaching staff.
Yes, they have to. Teaching staff, not the students. Teaching staff. They need to be vaccinated. See, we can't see. The larger question is, how long are we going to wait? Are the risks outweigh the benefits? That's the question we need to ask. See, all over the world, the keeping children at home is not a problem for them also. It's a problem for the parents also. See, in a study, in a joint statement issued by UNICEF and UNESCO, what they have stated is, the world over, the parents are forced to forgo their employment to ensure that the children are safe at home. They're not able to leave the children at home. Their employment opportunities. See, the problem here again is this. The underprivileged, the vulnerable section, they are the most affected because of this closure of the schools. We can speak about all the other things, but in what way? We have not devised any policies for children, how to improve them or when they were at home. There were no schemes. The governments, whether it be the central government or any state government, devised any specific plans or special things to ensure that they are taken care of well, or whatever problems that is affecting them is taken care of. So this is the move which we have to take. and go as and how things happen and innovate and modify whatever the protocols. The experts have spoken about so much of protocols. We'll have to ensure that these protocols are strictly followed. And when there are non-compliances, and strict action should be taken for those non-compliances. This is how we can move forward. And this is not an issue that is unique to India. This is an issue that is being faced all over the world.
Okay, let me also say good evening to two more panelists who are joining me. As I thanks Mr. Sarvanan for joining us, I say good evening to Dr. Bura Garg, former MP for TRS, and Dr. Sunil Agar, Professor of Excellence Community Medicine at Maulana Azad College. He's also a member of the Lancet Commission and the COVID India Task Force. Dr. Garg, the debate really continues. We've managed to cull out some data from states, individual states, where schools have reopened a month ago, 3 weeks ago, or even 10 days ago. And the states where the schools have been open for at least a month have shown a rise in the positivity rate. Should that be a cause of concern? And then how do we deal with our going back to school policy?
Tanvi, thank you so much for having me on the show. Number one, I'd like to say that reopening the classes is not a trade-off between the social, economic, educational, and the developmental needs of the children and the speculation of apprehension of adverse consequences, which we are talking just now. You see, this is bound to happen that whenever you see the offices open or, you know, the schools open, or there would be few children who would be infected. That is there. We have to see that. But we have to see the overall denominator. In countries' context today, we are talking of 32 crore children. And this pandemic has really exposed the divide between the equity and equality which exists, you know, between different parts of the country. So we have to see that exactly what are we gaining and what are we losing, you know, exactly. So in terms of, you know, when you talk of infections, we have to be very clear that what denominator are we talking of. Let's say in a school, if there are 1,000 children and if there are 100 children which are infected, that does not bother me, because infection in children is milder, that, you know, recover over a period of time. And particularly when we talk of under 5 children, 5 to 10 years of old children, you know, basically those children will get infected for a period of about a week and then they recover faster. So that is one thing which is very, very important, and we have to keep in mind the hospitalizations are much less, the moderate cases are much less in cases of children. So, you know, even if the infection is there in children, that will be milder and they are not a risk, you know, basically. And the second thing which is very important is that this is an appropriate time. We have utilized children in many ways, in polio program, also, you know, in other economic, in other social initiatives like Say No to Crackers. And they have been important messengers of change. And I was talking on your panel last time also that, you know, in our country, approximately out of 150 people wear masks and only 15 people are wearing correctly. So that is where if we are, you know, child-to-child connect, child-to-teacher connect is very, very important. We have interviewed couple of, you know, children. We have interviewed, you know, couple of teachers. We have interviewed couple of, you know, parents also on behalf of Indian Association of Preventive and Social Medicine. And, you know, we are going to share this complete information with the Department of Health, Department of Education, and Ministry of Women and Child Development. We should not forget that basically there are also preschool children who go to Anganwadis and get their non-formal preschool education. So everything at this moment is compromised. As a public health expert, it does not bother me, you know, that the children are suffering from, you know, infection, because I know that they suffer from milder form infections also. And in first and second wave also, we got approximately 3% of the children who got infected, and they were little more in children between 11 to 17 years of age. So that is one thing which we have to keep in mind. So, you know, it is something like one of the, you know, teachers said earlier, the board was, you know, black, the future was bright. Now the screens are white and we are probably heading for a dark future for the students. So that is where we need to keep all that in mind. And we have to see that the parents say that we do not know, you know, who are the persons, you know, so we have to keep everything in mind. And we also have to keep in mind that there is a big rural and urban divide. In rural areas, already there is no COVID-appropriate behavior. There is no concept of, you know, basically social distancing or physical distancing and the sanitization part. Even if they will go to school, all these things will also be taken care of. So we are talking of 67% of the population And when we talk of 32 crore children, so out of them, 67 crore are there in the rural areas.
Yeah.
So we have to see that, do they have an access? The children are sent off, and particularly girls are sent off to other kinds of work, because they say, why do you need to sit in front of TV? You know, you can do this later on. High number of school dropouts, early childhood marriages have tremendously increased. We have gone back many, many years back, and it's a kind of a $1 trillion, you know, as per World Bank estimates, loss, which we have to keep that in mind.
Okay, so those are some very strong arguments you've made in favor of opening the schools right away. Of course, you know, several international organizations have also said the same. But each state, each country, each district actually,
yes,
has its own stories, its own problems. Each school, each class, you know, the backgrounds that the children are also coming from would add to it. Dr. Bagai, would you like to come in here to what Sunila Garg is also saying?
Yeah. Without taking away the importance that, of course, school education, child's mental orientation and mental health of children, hugely neglected part worldwide, are extremely important. But the real fact is that the large public private schools, which we and very often take as a cake, not home. A lot of schools, especially in schools outside the metros, will struggle with the local logistics of the COVID appropriate behavior. Again, I'm stressing, children carry the same viral load as adults. We are not dealing with the previous strain, which is the wild strain of last year. This strain is behaving differently. We know that it travels a lot longer. Children have long COVID symptoms. There is enough data published internationally on this. An asymptomatic carrier, even after 5 months up to 12 months, can have chronic heart or lung or brain involvement. The question is, we are at a fag end of this vaccination, trying to reach towards a particular percentage of herd immunity. We need to tide over these next 2 or 3 months. It's not a question of another year. It's a question of this semester, this 3 months or 4 months. We are 65 crores. It's a simple mathematics. At the rate which we are going, we will reach the 80% of a target vaccinable population achieved by end of December.
Okay.
Fine, we are past the summer months. We are entering into now, the next season is going to be the winter months. Ventilation will be an even huger problem with indoor transmission in winter. I'm only being cautious because children are precious.
So let me ask this question as well. And I say ask this because most parents just want to know this part. Whether they should wait for their children to be vaccinated, especially in the light of the fact that there is now approval that's been given to one brand, at least in our country, another one has applied. Is that a necessity? Is that a basic requirement? Dr. Bagai, to you and then Sunila Garg.
So the children vaccination in US is going on very, very smoothly. They've had almost a 95 to 96% effectiveness on the ground. There are very, very few cases of any side effects of mild, even myocarditis and things like that. It's extremely safe. There have been no thromboembolic phenomena in children. It's very safe. In India, we still have not got a vaccine which is licensed, approved for children. Even when we get it, say, in the next month or so, it will begin in the age group of 11 and 12 up to 18, not below.
Yes.
Keeping in mind that we are what we call as a cross-reactive immunity. By end of December, we have to tide over the next 1 or 2 months. I don't see children being vaccinated in India very quickly, at least for another 4 to 8 weeks. Even when it starts, it will start in a slow manner. We are looking at what we call as community-acquired immunity, which will be reached by December. Again, I'm stressing, it's 2 months to tide over.
Okay. Quickly, let me first just also bring in Dr. Bura Gaur on various states and the policies there. Dr. Gaur, we're seeing mixed data when it comes to the impact of reopening schools and the kind of rise in cases. While lots of states have decided that they will open the schools, it's not mandatory for students to go. But how will you handle it on ground? That's the first question any teacher or any parent is going to ask. It's okay to say, wear your mask, sanitize yourself, maintain distance, you know, sit far away from each other. But what happens the minute the teacher is out of the class? And until the next teacher comes, who's going to control the children then?
Regarding the children going to the school, we are caught between a devil and deep sea. On one hand, it's absolutely necessary children has to go to the school, but not at the cost of their lives. That's the most important. Now, there is no set parameter. Nobody can say, I've been listening to all the panelists. Nobody can say with authority, with a conviction that this is going to happen. A particular timetable we are able to control. But a standard thing is, each state, depending on the prevalence of the COVID, they have to take a decision. Probably each district also has to take a decision. A hybrid model where in our state, where the children, parents allow, they can go to the offline class. Where the parents are apprehensive, they can take the online classes also. That is one model. Where you are not forcing the parents to send the children to the school. That's it. Second thing is, we have set up the protocols. The set of the protocols is different. See, we have got so many schools, about 40,000 schools. Each school need to be implemented in letter and spirit, whether it's a private or public. That's more important. Not having the only, everybody knows what is the protocol to control the COVID, but how to implement it in letter and spirit. From the school, children going from the living to the home, coming back to the home, till that time, how to protect the child. Third thing, as you said, there is an intense divide between the facilities available, urban, rural, rich, middle, and poor children. And fourth is, most important one, the data which I have shown, many of the states show there is slight rise in the infection rate among the children. But more important is, though we know the mortality rate is very, very less, severity is very less among the children, but children are much more precious than adults in terms of emotional. In terms of emotional, see, if an adult person, 70% years or 50 years, 60 years person dies, it is not a such a. But even in a 1,000 school, which is 1,000 children, if the even two children gets affected, becomes severely affected, or goes a systemic inflammatory syndrome, that will shake the faith in the decision.
Yes.
So I need to, that will really shake the, it's not a question of numbers. It is a question of the child. Each child is precious to the family and also society.
Do you think the state government of Telangana is prepared to handle that kind of a situation? I will give you instances in the state of Punjab, where schools reopened a month ago, and there have been multiple instances of schools where there's been a breakout. 20, 30, 50 cases that have come. Earlier, similar instances came from Kerala as well, Dr. Gaur. That's something that each state needs to know and prepare for.
Yeah, that is very important. See, simply because it is not like experiment with the children. Probably we can experiment with ourselves as adults, allowing, opening, the unlocking things and trying to check slowly. But here, the second problem is we have not started the vaccination of the children. I think that is also a priority, because now the Johnson is approved, and even the Covaxin trials are going on. We should try to vaccinate children also as early as possible, as many people of them as possible. Mm-hmm. And it is like a, I don't think anybody with a conviction will say, okay, this is the timetable. This is going to be happen. We need to be prepared. We have to open the schools, take the precautions, see that the protocols are followed, not only given on the lecture or in the pamphlet. They have to followed. And if there is any rise in the case, if there is any mortality, if there is any severe, then immediately we have to take back our decision. It should be a dynamic decision, not a static decision. I think no political decision should be made. It's only absolutely, we have to follow the medical decision, evidence-based decision, not at all. Just because children are sitting home, let us try. But we cannot put the children's life at risk.
Okay, any fair parent, enough. Yes, fair enough. I get your point. There is one other aspect that was raised here multiple times, and I want to take that to Dr. Haseeja now. Dr. Haseeja, the practicality of it, Dr. Bagai spoke about ventilation and how that can be a challenge in many places. Yes, in some instances, you can get the students out of the buildings, but that may not be possible everywhere. transport is the other one. How do you get the children to school? And if you can actually ensure that the same precautions are maintained while they are traveling to school, during the break time, you know, between different classes, is that a big challenge to your mind?
I personally feel, let's look at it, we are handling two set of children. One are which are at private unaided school, second which is government aided or government school there. When you talk about private unaided school, I believe that all schools are very well equipped. They have funds, resources, and they have a mindset to take care of all these issues. And they have been taking care of it very, very well. But when I talk about the other set of the children who are going to government aided and government school, believe it, they must come to school. A, they have to take the midday meal or other thing. Apart from that, you know, they need to come out of that close wall where they don't have a healthy and hygiene living. They must come to school to connect with their teacher. I again say, teacher is not the only source of knowledge. When we talk about teacher is only a facilitator. Learning would happen, but it is the connect with the children. And that connect can happen in the corridor, in the classroom, outside the classroom, in the ground. But that peer group is very, very important. Believe it, when last year this happened and government announced this year, January 2021, to reopen the school, most of the school modified their infrastructure. Most of the school invested into the cyber infrastructure so that online could go on. As on today, I strongly believe everybody is ready for hybrid model. Mm-hmm. Yes, we should make it mandatory, but that inspiration to connect with the peer group, connect with the teachers, and learn in collaboration and competition. These are the important skills which we must inculcate, and I strongly believe we all are ready for it.
Might I also add, for you know, for some also to get away from the constantly prying eyes of the parents, to get a break from their parents and to be with their friends, and I think it does have an impact on the children's mindset as well. Dr. Garg, you know, my last question to you on the vaccination part, because a lot of parents believe so, some of the governments say so as well, that until children are vaccinated, maybe we shouldn't look at you know, reopening schools to a great extent.
Tanvi, one thing I'd like to bring to your attention, and we have discussed it also many times, that 60% of the children have been found to be seropositive even if they have not gone to school, number one. Number two is that we do have approval of one company, but one thing we have to again remember, once adults are protected, children are protected. Even if vaccines will come, we will have to give, you know, we cannot immediately say that 15 crore vaccines are there for the children. We have to prioritize. And we have to start prioritizing from 17 years onward to 16 and 15 and all. And also we have to look at children who are comorbid, suffering from obesity or from non-communicable diseases, which are now quite common in children. They should be vaccinated first. And as I told you, that children who are younger, less than 5 years of age and between 5 to 10 years of age, infection, they recover faster. If we are worried about MIS, that happens in a very small number. That does not happen in much larger numbers. So that is one thing which we have to keep in mind. We have to act rationally, and we also will have to act because India is like many, many states. If today I was to talk of Kerala, where there is 20%, you know, test positivity, then definitely I will see that, okay, I'll wait for some time.
Yes.
And Kerala is digitally also very, very advanced. So that is where we have to see that. There are 5 states now when I talk of, you know, Sikkim, or when I talk of, you know, Meghalaya, or when I talk of Manipur and all, wherever the seropositivity is above 10%, we wait for some time.
Okay.
And they're smaller states, you know. So that is where we have to see that we need to keep everything into consideration. But as of now, vaccine is not a priority for the children, except the ones who are older children and who are suffering from comorbidities.
Yes.
As in when the vaccine comes in September, October, we can give the vaccine to them.
And I think, you know, we will also look towards the government and the ICMR to come out with a policy for that as well. If you're going to prioritize the only one brand which will be available at that time, and if it is for children above the age of 12 or 15 or 17, what's the priority order? Those with comorbidities all of that will also have to be looked at. Completely out of time, but a big thank you to all of the panelists who've joined us on this conversation. There seems to be a larger consensus that for the good of the children themselves, it is time that they get back to schools. For the better mental health of children, not just about their academics, it is time that they get back to schools. Most states are currently willing to experiment with a hybrid model. The teachers themselves, principals themselves are saying it's quite possible in most parts of the country, but we will have to wait and watch how it works on ground. Yes, there are many states where after the schools reopen, more cases amongst children have come out. But some experts say that it's not a concern yet because the cases aren't severe. Others do say that data suggests there are still many severe cases, which also should not be okay. And we can just wait for a few more months before we open up. In a few more months, India's vaccine coverage will be higher. And then it would perhaps be okay to take this risk. Any which ways right now, it's not mandatory to send your child to school, even if you are in a state where schools have reopened. So individually, the districts, the states will have to look at all the local factors before taking a decision. And of course, the final decision will be of that of the parent. Thank you for joining us on this conversation.